Okay, now we open another paragraph of this chapter, un altro paragrafo di questo capitolo, about phenomenological aspects. We will talk about dynamic bifurcation. We will examine three examples of dynamic bifurcation. Is a system in which one or more parameters change in time. Alcuni parametri dipendono dal tempo. Secondo la legge nota, parameter depending on time. I will give you a very funny example. I could see several years ago in a conference. For example, look at the motion of my body when I move in this way. It is governed by the inertia, remember in physics one, the moment of inertia with respect to the vertical axis which passes through my body, which governs this motion. But if during this motion I move the arms in this ridiculous way, the inertia moment is changing with a law, con una legge, that I am deciding. So is the motion of a rigid body whose inertia moment changes in time according to a law. So this is a parametric excitation, since the excitation is due not to an external forces on the system, but on the fact that one or more parameters are changing during the motion. A much more interesting example is the swing, the valtellina. Do you know the valtellina or swing when the boy is on the swing and he moves in this way on the swing, on the swing. So the valtellina moves and the boy usually, which is on the swing, changes its position. And the mother or the father moves in this way according to the motion of the swing. But he doesn't know, he or she doesn't know why it has to move in this way in order to excite the altalina. And you, the altalina swing. And if you are so clever in moving in a proper way, the altalina is excited. So you have a parametric excitation of altalina due to the fact that a mass is changing. What's the mathematical model? Is the pendulum with moving mass, and therefore with varying length, since the length of the pendulum changes in time according to the position of the center of mass of the body on the swing. Okay, similar to this way, I'm changing my inertia moment. By moving this way, I am shortening or increasing the length of the pendulum. So it is the pendulum with varying length. Okay. Pendulum with varying length. You know the equation of the pendulum. Theta 2 dots plus g is gravitational acceleration, theta is equal to 0, not theta, this is linearized, non linear, is sine of theta equal to 0. You can say you don't have any excitation to the right hand member, there is no an external force on the system, but it is a parameter which is changing in time according to a known law. So it is known. So from a mathematical point of view, we have differential equations with variable coefficients. Differential equations in time with variable coefficients. But variable is too large word, and usually we refer to periodic motions. That is, the parameters are varying with a periodic law. In this way or in this way. So usually this is periodic. It is understood, sottinteso, quando si dice accelerazione parametrica, si pensa periodica. Perché l'unica che si sa risolvere. In questa unica case we are able to solve. In mathematics there is a theory which is called Floquet theory, which is the French mathematician which solved the problem of linear equations with periodic coefficients. So from a physical point of view, we are studying systems with parameters which depend on time. In the structural analysis, the paradigmatic system, esempio paradigmatico, cioè quello che raccoglie diciamo l'essenza del problema, is the Bolognian beam. Bolognian beam. Even Bolognian is a very important Russian professor who died, I think, at the end of the last century. I had the occasion to meet him just one time in Rome. He gave a seminar, at a seminario a Roma. Unfortunately, he was attacked by some people zingari in quell'occasione e venne al seminario con la giacca sporca di pomodoro rosso. It was attacked by some young people. It was our visit, biglietto da visita for a very important professor visiting Rome, unfortunately. And he gave a seminar. He wrote a very nice book, two books maybe, which are Pietre Miliari, Miller Stones of. Theory of stability in dynamics. Okay, the Bolognian beam is the dynamic version of the Euler beam. We have a rule which depends on time. P is P naught plus mu. For example, Rosanne, P. Dynamics. This is P statics, this is P dynamics, cosine omega t. So the load is made of a static part and a dynamic part. So the load follows this rule, cosine. This is the load as a function of time. This is the static quota part, and this is the dynamic quota part. It's very important in studying supports of machines, when you have a floor, a basement, un pavimento, un basamento, you have a machine. It is the machine solicitate the structure, so misura la struttura con il suo peso proprio, static part, and a dynamic part which is related to the rotation of a rotor. You have a rotor which transmits solicitation which are periodic with a frequency capital omega. So you have a solicitation which depends on time, which is linked to the frequency of agitation. You know the equation of the Euler beam in the linear field. You know that the equation is the flexural carrying capacity plus P leaves a space, second derivative equal to zero. This is the funicular load capacity, and this is the flexural load capacity. The beam bends, and this is the contribution. The beam behaves as a cable, since it is solicited by an axial force, which can be beneficial or detrimental, questo è beneficial malefica, according to this fraction of compression. Now, in our problem, in the Bolotti beam, the load is not constant, and therefore we have an equation like this. This is non-linear. You have the linearized version, this is theta, in the linear field, in which there are some coefficients of the equation. This is an ordinary equation, this is a differential equation. Anyway, you have some equation with coefficient which depends on time. No, this is a homogeneous problem. You don't have an external excitation. The external excitation acts as a coefficient of the homogeneous part of the equation. That is important, which is some different. For example, if I solicit this beam with transverse force, I should put the forces here as an external excitation. But now it is an excitation of the proper characteristics of the systems, not describing the interaction with the environment. No? When you have a wind force on a body, the wind force represents the action of the environment, dell'ambiente, of the structure. Now, in parametric excitation, you have an excitation of the intrinsic properties of the system. Stiamo cambiando le caratteristiche intrinsiche, per esempio, un momento di inerzia, oppure stiamo cambiando la lunghezza del pendolo. Quindi stiamo cambiando un parametro del sistema. Non lo stiamo incitando dall'esterno. So understand, please understand, reflect, think to the difference between external excitation and parametric excitation, which are two completely different things. Okay. So Bolotin studied this equation, and he found this result I just explained without any calculations. You can. So it is two parameters. Family, two parameter family. Since we have two bifurcation parameters, the amplitude of the load, the dynamic part of the load, and the parametric excitation frequency, two parameters. And I can plot a diagram which represents the boundary of stability of the trivial configuration, I ask myself, which are the combinations between the load, the dynamic load, and the frequency, which produce instability? Bolovin found a diagram like this. This is a simplified diagram, just to explain the phenomenon from a physical point of view, in which you have a region of unstable equilibrium, and the complementary part is stable. It means that if you are far from this resonant value, more precisely, parametric resonant value, the 2 omega, omega is 2 omega, where omega is the natural frequency of the medium. Which unfortunately you don't know since you didn't study dynamics. I have to explain that. When omega is close to a special value, I will explain later, you close to this value, you find an unstable region. That means that even for very, very small dynamic parts, loads, you have an unstable equilibrium configuration. That means that the beam doesn't remain straight. The beam bends here. Here you have the beam which bends. Even at the static load, less than the Eulerian load. So, for special values of the frequency, you can observe buffing at a load which is much lower than the Eulerian one, since this is a dynamic phenomenon. Okay? So Ps is, you can put here, is less than the Eulerian. Okay? For example, the Eulerian load is 10, you apply P static equal to 1, and then it is sufficient for a special frequency to have a very, very, very small dynamic part and the beam buckets. Okay? Buckets and oscillate frequency. What's this special value? You have to know that any object has a natural frequency. Maybe you know from physics. A pendulum has a linear frequency, which was studied by Galileo Galilei, who found that natural frequency is this coefficient here. The square of the natural frequency is this one. If you have a 2 degree of freedom, you have 2 natural frequencies. System can oscillate in 2 different forms, each of which has its own frequency, as in instability, 2 buffing forms and 2 buffing load. If you have a continuous system, that is an infinite parameter, infinite dimensional system, you have infinite frequencies, infinite natural frequencies. Let us put your attention on the first one, which is called, when you say the natural frequency, you mean you are looking at the fundamental one, the first one. For example, when you play the guitar, a guitar, you take a string, you pick the string and you leave, and you can hear a sound. That sound has a frequency which is the natural frequency of the string. This is not exactly true, since you have some other frequency, but the most important one is that one, is the natural frequency. If that occurs for any object, if you look to a mountain has a natural frequency. The mountain oscillates when earthquake, so is it, and then dies. It oscillates naturally at its own natural frequency. Any object has a natural frequency. On a glass, bicchiere, you hit the glass by the knife, un coltello di una botta, sentite un suono. Perché? Perché il bicchiere si sta deformando, lo vedete perché è di vetro, e sta oscillando. The glass oscillates and it vibrates with its natural frequency. This is a fundamental step of dynamics that unfortunately you will study later next year. So the beam has its natural frequency, omega. Well, Bolotin found that if the beam is parametrically excited at a frequency which is double of the natural frequency, the parametric excitation phenomenon is triggered. Si eccita il fenomeno dell'eccitazione parametrica e basta teoricamente un valore piccolissimo. Se introducete un damping, questo cambia un po', questa curva, questo è damping, smorzata. Se la trame è smorzata, vuol dire che ci vuole un valore minimo per attivarla. For not done, for undamped beam, at omega, capital omega, equal to omega, an evanescent low dynamic load triggers instability. At the same frequency, if you are damping, you have to overcome, to pass, to superare un valore di soglia, a threshold, un valore di soglia, should be passed. Ok? Why omega equal to omega? It's very strange. Not at all. Look at the motion, vertical motion, of point B. It is very interesting. In the linear field, point B doesn't move. But if you consider larger displacements, you can see this displacement of B. Okay? For large displacement, so here this is a sliding rod. So you have this displacement. Well, you can think by yourself. The frequency at which the point B moves is double of the frequency of the beam. Look, the beam is right, then it reaches this position, and it comes back to the right position. It traveled half a period, since in order to perform a whole period, performare un intero periodo, it has to move on the right, come back, move on the left, come back. This is a whole period. A whole period of a minute. But if you look at half period of this point, C, the point C goes on the right and comes back. Point B already performed a whole period, since it moves from here to here and comes back. Then the beam moves on the left, and point B performs another period. So point B moves vertically with a frequency which is double of the frequency of UC. So, if this is in time, the excursion of C, this is wood C in a period T, point B experiences much slower displacements, which are quadratic contribution, non linear. In linear field at zero, very smooth, but they experience to be a period when the transverse motion is half period and then repeats itself. Okay? What does it mean? It means that when the external excitation is 2 omega, the external excitation, the load, the vertical load, is in resonance with the beam. This is the explanation. I will try to be more clear. In order to have resonance, I hope you know what's the idea of resonance. At elementary school, they told to me that when a soldier moves on a bridge, they don't have to travel and to march with the same frequency of bridge, otherwise the bridge collapses. So if this load is P cosine or small omega T, you have resonance. Which kind of resonance? External resonance. Since the load moves in the same way, the beam would move by themselves. The glass would oscillate as he wants. If you move this, your fingers at the same frequency, you are exciting in resonance the glass, and the glass explodes. You know that by volume you can perform the explosion of a glass. Since the waves emitted by the volume are at the same frequency, so a pressure wave excitates the object with the same frequency, same natural frequency, and you have external resonance. And theoretically, the response is infinite. La risposta teoricamente è infinita. So it occurs when the external equal to natural. You have external resonance. But for parametric excitation, if you have cosine 2 omega p, you are in resonance with the beam, since this point moves at frequency double. So isn't it is still an external resonance, which is called parametric, since the forces enters the equation, parametric resonance. When the external is 2 times the natural, why the difference? Since this force works, lavora sullo spostamento del punto C. Questa lavora sullo spostamento del punto B. So the forces are working, spending work, on points which have a different frequency. Okay? Have you seen when you want to excitate your car and you make these motions on the suspensions, so the suspension, the springs of the car? If you excitate your car in this way, at the same frequency of the springs and the mass of the car, you are in a situation like this. You have to excitate the object with the same frequency in order to have very large oscillation. In parametric excitation, since this point moves in a different way with double frequency, you have double frequency. So this is the situation. What does it happen here? Theoretically, the oscillation goes to infinity in the linear field, in the unstable region. You can observe oscillations diverging in time. Non-linearities, however, non-linearities, this is linear, can stabilize these oscillations. You can say for the Bolovi beam that the beam experiences very large oscillations. Okay. But if you approach the problem in a linear way, theoretically they go to infinity. Is it clear? I hope so. I hope notwithstanding you don't know dynamics. Not for the fault. Not the fault of us, but nostra. Okay, this is a good moment for
our student who had some other problems
to leave. I will talk about two additional problems. Second one concerns circulatory systems. They call that flutter. Which admit a potential. Mettono un potenziale gravitazionale, e perciò sono chiamate forze potenziali, potential forces. They are conservative. That means that you can perform a cycle, puoi fare un ciclo, and they spend zero work. They are conservative forces, you know, from physics. But there are some other forces which are not conservative and depends on the position of the body. So they are called positional forces. So the forces F depends on the position of the body. For example, if you have you have a rocket and you have a reaction rocket, un razzo a reazione. Of course, if the rocket put in this way, the force F follows the rocket, doesn't maintain the vertical position. The rocket describes, for example, a parabola, and the force follows. So it is a case of external force which depends on the configuration. It is a rigid motion for the rocket. But you can think also to an elastic beam, which may be the force bend, the rocket undergoes a flexural deformation, and nothing, the force changes. This example is encountered, for example, when you flood your garden, quando innalzi il giardino, by the tube, the pipe conveying the fluid, un tubo che porta liquido. And you put on the ground, you open the tap, apri il rubinetto, se lo apri poco, se if the, la portata è piccola, if the flow is small, the pipe is at rest on the garden, grass superman. If the flow is larger, it starts to move. And it experiences large motions. The force exerted by the mass which leaves the pipe has the same with reverse sign, represents a follower force for the pipe. And it will experience an instability depending on the amplitude of this force, the amount of this force, which induces a phenomenon which is called flutter, and I will explain why. Another nice example is il pattino sul ghiaccio, sculpture on ice. You have I don't remember sky, spianti. Questo pattino che qui voi avete una lama. This is an object, and this is ice, and it is moving in the plane, and you perform the derapage, for example, derapage by the skis. You know, you put your body on a side of the ski. It's the same. When this is moving, you have a friction force, which is orthogonal to the blade, orthogonal alla lama. No? In curva, sta andando in curva, la lama affonda nel ghiaccio e voi avete una resistenza nel mezzo del ghiaccio che è orthogonale alla lama. Quindi se la lama si muove, che voi state facendo una curva, the force follows the body. So, all friction forces, are follower forces, since they depend on the attitude, dipendono dall'assetto del corpo. Okay. Look on YouTube, there is a nice lecture in English by Professor Hume, which show you an experiment about instability due to friction forces. You look, maybe it's called Bigumi system, or you find the flutter keywords, Professor Bigumi and flutter on YouTube, you find the lecture. It's very nice. You can see that's it. He performed to show that friction forces can induce flutter instability. Okay. In structural mechanics, the paradigmatic system is the back beam. Back beam. Any system has a name people introduced. Back started cantilever beam. And then a follower force, P or mu P, that means that in the linear field the force follows the beam. Okay. And he found that for sufficiently large mu, you can observe a dynamic bifurcation which is represented in this way. For mu less than mu critical, you have decreasing oscillations in time. If you have some damping, of course, plus damping. Otherwise, when mu is larger than uc, They increase in time in the linearized field. Of course, if you study the problem in a non-linear field, you can find that this oscillation stabilizes on a certain amplitude. This is non-linear. If you look to this phenomenon in the phase plane, il piano delle fasi, lo spazio di stato, e this you have Q and Q dot, to have Q, for example, this increase displacement. You can see in the nonlinear field that there exists a limit factor. At which the system tends in an infinite time when mu is larger than a critical value. Okay. And correspondingly, after a transient, the oscillation stabilizes. So for your pipe in the garden, you can see that there is a transient and then the system oscillates on a limit cycle. And you can see a discrete version of the back field performed by Professor Tiburi of Trento University a few years ago. If you start out of this limit cycle, is for example, this is the system at equilibrium, you put out of the limit cycle orbit, and you can say that the limit cycle is attractive, il ciclo limite è attrattivo, e quindi oscilla sempre a quella certa ampiezza quando il carico eccede il carico critico. Ovviamente l'ampiezza dipende dal valore del carico. Tanto più il carico è grande, tanto più diventano grandi queste ampiezze. Quindi I said in Italian, the amplitude of limit cycle, this one, this is the amplitude from A to minus A if the system is symmetric, depends on mu, of course. And therefore we can plot a bifurcation diagram which say that when mu is less than mu critical, you just have a trivial equilibrium position, but it is convenient to put a third dimension. When mu is larger than mu critical, you have an orbit, for example this one, a family of orbits which depends on the load. So you have to see in 3D, lo devi guardare in 3D, dove si ha un moto, c'è solo la posizione di equilibrio ma c'è il moto. And we say that a dynamic bifurcation occurs at the critical point. Punto critico, usiamo una bifurcazione perché, since from a static equilibrium, an orbit arises, cioè nasce un'orbita da una posizione di equilibrio. Questa è la definizione di bifurcazione dinamica. This is the definition of dynamic bifurcation. A static bifurcation is when a new equilibrium arises from an old equilibrium. Equilibrium changes in some other equilibrium position. Static bifurcation. A bifurcation is dynamic when a dynamic motion arises, bifurcates from a static one. You just have the equilibrium of the loading beam. When the load is sufficiently large, the equilibrium becomes unstable, and look, this is the trivial equilibrium, which is unstable. When you start close from it, the motion goes away and tends to some other factor. So the bifurcation is dynamic, the dynamical pile, when an orbit arises, bifurcates from an equilibrium. This is the difference between static and dynamic bifurcation. Just a mechanical consideration that could be interesting. Why follower forces are non-conservative? Also, the elastic forces depend on the specific. Explain, elastic forces are positional forces, since it depends on the position of one of the ends of a spring. But not all the positional forces are conservative. The elastic ones are derived from a potential. The follower force cannot be derived from a potential. They do not admit a potential. And Bolotin explained this in a very simple way. In order a force is conservative and therefore it admits a potential, it must spend zero work on any closed loop. Okay? Lavoro nullo su qualunque circuito chiuso. If there is even one loop in which the force spends non-zero force and non-zero work, then it is not conservative. So the idea is we have the beam in this position and we want to put this beam in the thing. This is the initial, this is the final position. I have two ways to arrive to the final position. For example, look, here we have a displacement V of point B and a rotation phi B. I can give first one and then the other. For example, first the translation, then the rotation, or vice versa. Okay? So to move the system from O to F, final position, I can follow two paths. The work must be this will be should be the same in order the force is conservative. If I can prove they spend different work on an open path, on the same path they spend different two different paths from O to F following two different paths to arrive at the same point. If the work along one is different from work along two, it is non-conservative. Do you agree? Since if I want from O to F following path one and came back F to O, coming back to the woods. If the two works are different, the total work is different from Z. For example, 10 and 12, I spend work 10 minus 12 is not Z. Okay? So this is the idea. I can put first first move the beam from position with zero rotation, and then fixed at the point I rotate. During the first step, the work is zero, since the tangent is there. Then I rotate, the force rotate, but doesn't spend the work, since it doesn't move. So the work is zero. Along path one is zero. Try the reverse. First, rotate, zero work, since the force doesn't move, but then move, this is zero, but this is not zero, since the force is moving, and therefore, now it is different from zero. So, exchanging is the work. You understand? First the rotation, then the displacement. During the phase rotation phase, force doesn't spend work, since the application point is fixed. Then move, and then you have the horizontal component of this force perform work. This is zero work. Non-zero working. Okay? And therefore, following two different paths, you have two different results. This is very interesting. As an engineering explanation of the non-existence of a potential for four follower forces. Okay. This type of bifurcation is called the flutter. Simply, it was observed in bridge under some circumstances in which you have a torsional movement of the bridge. We will see better in the next example, which resounds the battito d'aria della farfalla. Butterfly. Okay. It is a strange origin in the technical world. In mathematical world, it is called the hot bifurcation. So, butter is technical. Hot bifurcation is mathematical. The best is to say dynamic bifurcation. Even if also dynamics are a little bit more generic. Third and last example, maybe even more interesting for civil engineers. Dynamic bifurcation is triggered by wind. Wind load can trigger o suscitare biforcazione dinamica. The most clear example in the literature is the failure of the Tacoma Narrow Bridge. Anyone knows Tacoma Bridge? Who in, I think, in 1940 failed after some hours, maybe 2 days, I don't remember, of oscillations, finally it collapsed due to this phenomenon. To understand the phenomenon, just a few words. You have a body, a cylinder of some shape, for example, a square, rectangular, or what you want, except that circular, which is a special case. To simplify things, I admit that this box, this subject, is called Gauss. In the technical literature. And then you have just 1 degree of freedom. It can just moves along the vertical. For example, you have a beam which is hit by a wind flow, and we are observing the motion in the vertical plane. First stage, the wing is horizontal, the galloping is vertical. When do you observe this phenomenon? Have you seen, in Italian it's called nastro segnalatore, it's called a string, so substantially you have an horizontal string which is under horizontal wind flow, and you can say it oscillates in the vertical direction. Some strips, plastic strips, do you remember plastic strips usually are red and white? Have you seen? Not plastic narrow strips which are taut in horizontal, just to the sign of crime of movies on TV. But TV police put these strips, maybe yellow, red and black. Under the wing, it oscillates vertically. It's very strange, since the wing is horizontal and the oscillations are vertical. So, not clever engineers, which ignores stability, think it is an external oscillation phenomenon. No, it is an instability phenomenon, which is very interesting. Like this. If the object, the beam, the string, is subjected to an initial imperfect, initial motion, which puts it in motion, it of course has a velocity. It's not at rest. It means that someone introduces an initial condition to put it in movement, which is very easy in the real world. So, the wind, this is the absolute velocity of a wind, but you have a Q dot, which is the velocity of the body, and therefore the wind hits the body with a relative velocity, U up. So you are seated on the body. The body is experiencing a velocity Q dot. This is the velocity of your frame, reference frame, è la velocità di trascinamento, cioè la velocità del sistema in cui voi state. Allora, se questa è la velocità assoluta, if this is absolute velocity, this is the relative, since the relative velocity plus the velocity of the frame is equal to the absolute velocity. So, it is true that the wind is horizontal, but you that are seated on the body, you are hit by a wind which has an inclination with respect to horizontal. Since this is the relative velocity which is seen by the body. The body is investita, so seriously, investita is hit by the wind under a certain angle which is called the attack angle. The attack angle is the angle with which the relative velocity invests the body. Of course, the alpha angle depends on the velocity. So, the direction of the relative velocity depends on the response of the system. Okay? Well, you know that in the wind gallery that when you put a bowl, a cylinder, under the wind flow, you can experience and to measure a drag force and a lift force. This is that, this is great. Here the body is at rest. The body is fixed. You put a cylinder in a galleria del vento, in a wind tunnel, and you can measure the drag, which is the resistance of the medium, la resistenza del mezzo, che studiavamo fisica, quella stessa che sperimenta l'automobile quando voi correte e sentite, oppure andate in bicicletta e sentite il vento che vi viene in faccia e vi frena. Quella è la forza di drag. When you are on the cycle, you can feel the resistance of medium, which is the drag force, which is also called the along wind force. So the force is aligned to the wind. Okay? But if the body has a cross-section different from circular, different, it should be not circular, you can experience a lift force. Of course, these forces are the integral of the pressures which are acting on the body. Integral of pressures. Pressure. If the body is circular, there is, for reason of symmetries, you don't have lift. But for any other shape, you have lift force. Lift force is very important for airplanes. Without lift forces, the plane cannot fly. I don't know, not go fly. We need a lift towards the top, not toward the lift force. In Formula 1, al contrario, noi vogliamo una lift force verso il basso per impedire il distacco delle ruote dalla pista. In Formula 1, you need a lift force toward the okay. In order the wheels do not detach and you lose adherence with the pavement. So the lift force are important. They are cross wind. Cross wind. They are along wind. Well, get back to our problem. In our problem, this is the relative velocity, and therefore you have, put with another color, you have the drag force and the lift force, which are on the body. Since they're along wind, which wind? Relative wind. Since what is important is the relative motion between the wind and the body, not the absolute. Since they are moving with velocity Q dot. So you have, maybe I can make a better plot. This is the two relative. So you have a long wind is that, cross wind is lift. Project these forces here in the vertical direction, and you have the resultant force F, which is the projection F in the y direction. For example, this is x, this is y. F y is the total force in y direction. So this force depends of course on Q dot. Since the direction depends on Q dot and the force itself, the modulus of force of course depends on the upper angle. You understand that if the body is invested by the wind in one direction, it suffers some forces. If the forces, if the wind change direction, you have other forces. So the reason is double. The modulus of L and D depends on alpha with the value of U. Since it means diciamo che il vento investe la struttura, vede la struttura in un modo diverso, a seconda della sua orientazione. So, force depend on the attack angle, since they depend on the way in which the wind sees the structure. The direction of M and D depends on alpha, and therefore F way depends on Q dot. So we have a body which undergoes forces which depends on its state. Force which depend on its velocity. We have velocity-dependent forces. Velocity-dependent forces. Then, if I put here a spring and a dashpot, a spring of stiffness K, a dashpot of coefficient, viscosity coefficient Cs. S means structural. And the body has a mass M. I can write the motion equation of the first cardinal equation of dynamics, which is M U dot, which is the inertia force, plus the damping force, plus the elastic force. This is inertia. This is damping force. This is elastic force. And then you have F way, which depends on Q dot. It is not a long term, but it depends on Q dot. If you linearize this force as a coefficient, an aerodynamic coefficient multiplied Q dot, we assume, of course, the force depends non linearly from Q dot, but I can take the linear approximation. This is the aerodynamic coefficient. I prefer to put minus sign here, so I linearize. You understand that this coefficient has the same form of this one. So you understand that the wind, through this mechanism, modifies the damping properties of the structure. The damping properties are usually of dissipative nature. Only this C is positive, and therefore you have the gating oscillations. Then the structure, it dissipates energy, and therefore it has a stabilizing effect. But you have a competitive mechanism. You have un meccanismo competitivo in cui il vento entra a modificare i parametri del sistema. The wind enters in the left-hand side of the equation to modify the coefficients. Not that the coefficients do not depend on time, but now the total damping is not only of structural nature, but also of dynamic, aerodynamic nature. And therefore, according to the sign of the aerodynamic coefficient, wind can be stabilizing or unstabilizing. It can be a beneficial or a detrimental effect. Questo è benefico o malefico? Dipende dal segno, cioè dipende dalla forma aerodinamica del corpo. The shape of the body establishes if this contribution is stabilizing or destabilizing. In the first case, it increases the total damping. In the last cases, it decreases the total damping. Therefore, if the total damping remains positive, you have an oscillation which they gain in time. But if damping changes sign at sufficiently high wind velocity, it becomes unstabilized. And you can say that the wind galloppa. This term galloping has been invented for cables. You have cables of electrical lines which are circular. But in the north of the world, north del mondo, they are glassed, sono ghiacciati. I cavi sono circolari, ma poi si forma il ghiaccio intorno. Ice concretion, which changes the shape of the cable, and lift force rises, and according to the shape of ice, can be beneficial or detrimental. If it is detrimental, the cable gallops vertically. Il cavo galloppa. And we observe this phenomenon in towers and similars and nelle torri, nelle ciminiere, ma non sono circolari, sono ellittiche per esempio, e vedo i lampioni, the lights in the street, when are under wind flow, they gallops transversely to the wind. The wind is not an external excitation as some unaware engineer and even professor thinks. Tacoma Narrow Bridge doesn't collapse due to the force of wind. It's not a static phenomenon, it's an instability phenomenon. Since the motion of the bridge combined with the wind produces a wind velocity, which produces drag forces, which induce an apparent damping, which balance and overcame the structural damping, and therefore the total damping becomes negative. Negative means that energy is put from the environment on the structure, on the system. Positive damping, the system dissipates in the environment energy. The opposite occurs here. Therefore, the mechanism is of instability. So we learn, and I will discuss that next time, that in the air wind we have faults which are depending on force, on position, positional forces. In the dynamic bifurcation, we can have force depending on velocity, that their linear part decides about stability. This is called galloping in the technical literature of bifurcation in mathematics. This is enough for today. See you next week. Thank you.